It's that time of year again, and Resonance FM needs your help. We've been at the cutting edge of community arts broadcasting for more than a decade. We don't run ads, we don't have fixed playlists, and most of all, we respect our listeners. We have one of the most diverse collection of radio broadcasts that you will find anywhere in the world. And in order to keep the ship afloat, we appeal to you to help us out during our annual fundraiser. This year, Resonance Fundraising Week runs from Saturday the 3rd of February to Sunday the 11th. Over the course of this week, there are a number of ways you can help us out. You can make a regular or one-off donation. You can bid on cultural curiosities in our infamous eBay charity auction featuring one-of-a-kind items and once-in-a-lifetime experiences. And of course, you can come party with us at one of our fundraising events. For more details, visit fundraiser.resonance.fm. Help keep Resonance on the air.
I'm God.
Bingo! Yahtzee!
Is that your final answer?
Our survey says God!
Bing, 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 bing.
I am not crazy. I'm just a little emotional right now, okay? Y'all throwing all this stuff at me, man. But after this is over, could I, like, get a hug from you or something?
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, a film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and TV. My name is Marcus E. Acko, and my favorite actor who has played God is... I'll say who it is, and then I'll come back to why I'm flip-flopping. It's Morgan Freeman in Bruce Almighty.
I don't think that's such a bad choice.
I'll explain why.
Oh, gosh.
Okay?
Yeah, we're not moving.
Swiftly, move along to the next section. No. Go on, your turn.
Well, I'm not sure whether this one's allowed either, but
my favourite
actor who plays God...
Tell us who you are,
By the way, my name's Laura Sampson. I'm a person.
A person.
Who is sitting in this chair right now.
You miss one episode of the show and you just completely wipe us out of your memory, and that's basically it. You come back. That's what happens.
I'm Laura Sampson, and my favourite actor who plays God in a movie, or is it God, is Gloria Foster in the first Matrix film as the Oracle. Maybe it's the cookies rather than her.
It's the cookies that you liked. Fair enough.
But I'm definitely going to go with her.
Okay, with us in the studio, two directors of the movie God Tech. Please tell us your name and who's your favourite actor or actress that played God.
I'm David John Jeffrey, and I'm going to cheat a little bit.
Go for it.
My favourite actor play God was Morgan Freeman in...
Evan Almighty. That's not cheating.
Morgan
the same
Freeman
actor.
Basically is God.
I'll come back to why there is it. But we have two directors in the room. Please tell us your name and your favourite actor or actress who played God.
Thank you. My name is Susanna Rodriguez. And I can't actually think of anyone else other than Morgan Freeman.
Okay. Now, let me come back to why I didn't want to say Morgan Freeman. Because he's the one person everyone's going to say. Apart from you, obviously, Laura. You forgot what show you were on, so I'm not going to mention you.
And I really like cookies, and Morgan Freeman doesn't eat cookies.
Yeah, and while yours was a strong choice, the reason why I didn't want to go with Morgan Freeman was because that's basically, as soon as he played God, everyone was like, yeah, that's fine. No one else needs to play God. I wanted to actually go with Alanis Morissette from the movie Dogma.
Oh.
It was a Kevin Smith movie, and she played God. Now, the problem with that is she only played God for like 5 minutes of the movie.
Yeah.
And she didn't say anything, and which is why I really liked her. She was very quirky. It was Alanis Morissette. But then compare that with Morgan Freeman, who had literally two movies, as you pointed out, Bruce Almighty and Evan Almighty, to show what he could do as God, and he did it so effortlessly. So it was like, so for me, it's a cross between Morgan Freeman
and Alanis Morissette. That's why I was so conflicted. I was thinking, oh, it's one or the other, but no, I've picked which one it is, and I'm going to stick with that. So you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I am Marcus E. Acko. Laura's in the room with, well, she was in the room with us, but obviously she must have been offended by what I said, and so she stormed off. With us in the studio today, two directors of the an upcoming movie called God Tech. We have Susana Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey. Hello and welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Coming up on the show, we'll have UK box office top five. We'll have our top five film and TV discussion. We'll also have Netflix and Amazon recommendations. Before we go to our next segment, I just wanted to give a plug out, a plug for two things first. First of all, if you follow us on Facebook, we're currently live streaming, so it's right over there. So everyone just wave to everyone, whoever is on Facebook watching us right now. So it's all over the place. We tried this last week, and it was literally 5 minute footage of this microphone. Now we're going a little better because I can see myself there. I can see our two guests, and Laura's hiding right in the corner or playing with her phone, one of the two. So it's fine. It doesn't matter. But anyway, so that was one thing I wanted to plug. So if you're on our Facebook page, if you're not, go to Shoot the Breeze at Resonance 104.4 FM on Facebook. You do that on Facebook and you can watch the live stream. The other thing I wanted to plug was Resonance's fundraiser. Resonance are raising funds in order to move locations. They've been very good to us, giving us this show. We've been very happy to work with all the lovely people that are here. This is pretty much where we met Laura. She came on board with us. So they have an auction that's beginning. When is it beginning, Laura? Is it next week?
Yes, it's beginning next week. This weekend, actually.
This weekend.
So the fundraiser runs from this weekend to next weekend, and for the purposes of donating money beyond that.
Excellent.
The auctions will all be sort of during that week as well.
Yeah, so the link to the auction is fundraiser.resonance.fm, or just go on the Shoot the Breeze Facebook website and look at all the posts that we have regarding the fundraising that we have. We have a fundraising account as well on Shoot the Breeze Shoot the Breeze Facebook page, but go to the website for the auction. It is fundraiser.resonance.fm. But now let's move to our next segment, which is film and TV news. So last week we talked Oscar nominations for 2018. We had Ikki El-Amriti in the studio with us talking about the Oscar nominations for 2018. Those of you who follow film news and award news know of another award called the Golden Raspberry Awards, also known as Razzies, which tend to follow the Oscars. They get announced around the same time the Oscar nominations get announced. They also get I think the award ceremony is actually on the day of the Oscars. So March the 3rd, the Razzies will actually come out. Now, it's wonderful to look at the list of films that come out on the Razzie list. And this year is, there's one thing in particular that really stood out for me, but I'll talk about it when we go through the categories. So just to check, you've all of you in the room, you've actually looked at some of the films that are being nominated for Razzies this year?
Yeah.
So, okay, you've seen some of them? Okay.
Yeah.
So just as we did with the Oscars for last week, we're going to go through the different categories. So we'll talk about worst picture, worst actress. Those are the categories, not like Oscars or best actor, etc. So it's worst picture, worst actress, worst actor, worst supporting actor, and worst supporting actress. So for worst picture, we have Baywatch. This is the the Rock, Zac Efron movie. We have the Emoji movie. Mm-hmm. We have 50 Shades Darker. The Mummy, not the original, the one from the late 90s with Brendan Fraser, but this is more the Tom Cruise The Mummy movie, mm-hmm. and Transformers The Last Knight. Okay, so how many have you seen? Laura, let's start with you. How many of those movies, Baywatch, Emoji Movie, 50 Shades Darker, The Mummy, Transformers, have you seen?
I have seen the Emoji movie.
Okay.
And I didn't actually think it was that bad. So I thought it was a bit, I thought it was quite unfair that it had been nominated in all of the categories that it could be nominated in, which mm-hmm. didn't include a live action actor or actress.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. I've seen the Emoji Movie and I had to stop it halfway through because, not even halfway through, I'd say 15 minutes in because my kids wanted to, well, they suggested that they wanted to watch it. I figured I'd check it out first. I started watching 15 minutes and I discouraged my kids from watching it. Luckily, my kid has some sense. Those of you who listen to the podcast, you know Jacob Acko. He's on episode 13. He watched Thor Ragnarok with me. So you know he has sense of what kind of movie. So when I said, trust me, you won't like this movie, he was like, okay, fair enough. Let's go find something else. And we went to go see Thor. So, hey.
Well, it was quite early in the morning when I did see it. So perhaps...
Still.
Perhaps I won't need to apologise for my lack of judgment in that. Do you think it's going to win in any of its categories? There's some pretty bad films here, aren't there?
This is the thing. The only reason why I don't think Emoji Movie will take it is because it's been panned already. It's basically been panned right from the movie the moment it came out. I think The Mummy will take it with Tom Cruise, mainly because while it wasn't necessarily a terrible film, I fell asleep in it and while watching it. But that's the thing. I think it was the fact that the level of expectation. It's a Tom Cruise movie. It's supposed to reboot the dark universe with, you know, the Wolfman and whatnot, and the Mummy and Dracula and so on. So you had Russell Crowe in it as, I'm going to spoil it, as Hyde, you know, Jekyll and Hyde. He's in it as well. And it was so underwhelming. So I think that's why it's going to take it. The fact that there was so much expectation and it flopped, I think The Mummy will take it. Although Transformers... the reason why I don't even think Transformers will be part of it is because Transformers, they went out, they set out to do what they did. They weren't expecting to get any Oscars, apart from for visual effects. And that's the movie that came out. The Mummy, on the other hand, thought it was serious, and that's why it went the way it did. Anyway, let's move on to the next category, Worst Actress. We've got Katherine Heigl from Unforgettable, Dakota Johnson from 50 Shades Darker, Jennifer Lawrence from Mother, Tyler Perry from Boo 2, A Madea Halloween, and Emma Watson from The Circle. Have you seen any of those movies?
No.
Okay. Laura, which ones have you seen?
No,
okay. I've seen Mother, I've seen Boo 2, A Madea Halloween. Don't ask me why I saw it.
You're with a friend.
I could have used that excuse, but no, here's the reason why I saw it. Okay, the UK audiences probably don't know much about the Madea movies. It's very big in America, mainly because of the actor Tyler Perry, who's an actress, just for those who don't know, although he's in the worst category, the worst actress category, is because his character of Madea
plays a woman.
Yeah. So that character is a woman played by a man. So that's why they put it as that. And Madea has a long string of movies. And very recently she has been doing the Halloween. So Boo, Madea Halloween, etc. And it's what it is. If you like the Madea movies, you will love this movie. I don't like the Madea movies because I watch it and I think, you're trying to crowbar a joke in there and it's not that funny. Yeah. So it does the same thing. The one person I feel, two people I feel sorry for in this list, and by sorry, I mean, I don't think they really deserve to be in this list, Jennifer Lawrence and Emma Watson.
Yeah.
With Mother, it's an abstract movie. It's basically it's a risky movie. It's something that they did not necessarily. People say it's terrible. I don't think it's that bad. I think it's a little confusing. But for it to be nominated as Razzie, hey, I'm not going to criticize their choices. I just feel bad for Jennifer Lawrence, especially the fact that I really like Jennifer Lawrence. I think she's an amazing actress. And this is basically now where I'll bring up what struck me about the Razzies list. The amount of Oscar winners. In this particular list, incredible. We have Jennifer Lawrence. We have Tyler Perry. Is someone's phone, or is it from upstairs? Okay, I think
it might be the street.
From the street.
It's pretty busy in the studio tonight. We've got people walking past.
We're being haunted. anyway, so it was Jennifer Lawrence. We'll move on to the list when we talk about worst actor. So let's move on to worst actor and see Tom Cruise from The Mummy. That was expected. He's not an Oscar winner. I don't even think yet, because I think he's past it, what he needs to have. Johnny Depp from Pirates of the Caribbean, Salazar's Revenge, or there's another name for it, but we'll go with Salazar's Revenge. So Johnny Depp nominated for Oscars loads of times. Anyway, Jamie Dornan from 50 Shades Darker, Zac Efron from Baywatch, Mark Wahlberg, who's Oscar nominated as well from The Departed, but from two movies, actually. He's nominated for Daddy's Home 2 and Transformers The Last Knight. So
how is that even possible? That's one of the things I think whenever I look at the Razzie list, there's always Oscar winners on it in films that perhaps their agents might have tried harder to dissuade them.
They need to pay rent too.
Is there an element, do you think, of the people who make these lists thinking about which actors would be up for it, would actually come and collect the award for worst actor at a month before collecting the award for best actor?
I don't think that. The reason why I don't think that, I know what you're saying, and much to her credit, Halle Berry is reputed for doing that. I think she's been nominated maybe twice at least, and she's shown up to collect them.
In years where she's won Oscars. Mm.
She's won one Oscar. She won the Oscar, and then I think it was the following year that she got nominated, but it was for a different movie. But she showed up. She did the whole crying thing that she did when she collected the Oscar. She did the same thing at the Razzie, which was amazing of her to do that.
Sandra Bullock as well.
Sandra Bullock, did she go to pick it up as well?
Yeah, she did. She got nominated for an Oscar basketball movie.
Blind Side. No, it's American Football. It's The Blind Side.
Yes. And then she got nominated for a Razzie for All About Steve, I think, in the same year. And I think she went to pick up both.
Yeah, there you go. So I don't think they do that intentionally to try and entice them to come and pick up the awards. Like, I don't know. The only person in these lists so far that I think would actually go and pick that up would be Jennifer Lawrence. Because what I've seen from her, from persona in interviews, etc., she sounds like the kind of person that would actually go and collect the awards. So I wouldn't be surprised if she actually won, that she would go and pick it up.
I think Emma Watson might too.
You think?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Although she's in so fewer well-reviewed things. Perhaps it would just sting a little bit too much.
True. I didn't get to see The Circle, but I'll need to see it to understand if she deserves to be in that particular category, but we'll see. Anyway, worst supporting actor, Javier Bardem, another Oscar winner. Mm. He's in there for two films, for Mother and for Pirates of the Caribbean, Salazar's Revenge. We have Russell Crowe for The Mummy. I mentioned that he was in there as Hyde, and he was terrible. It wasn't even the fact that he was terrible. I mean, there was... Okay. Here's why I didn't like his character. And they were crowbarring his character into the film, right? And there were points where I was watching it when I was awake. I was watching it and just thinking, no, hold on. You know that he's Jekyll, and he knows that he turns into Hyde. Everyone knows he turns into Hyde unless he injects himself with the syringe thing. It's like, why do you have to wait till the very last minute? Oh, no, not even last minute. Last second to inject yourself. You're just doing that to create dramatic tension. So the first time that he almost transforms, where he starts veining out and starts turning into Hyde, everyone runs out of the room. He picks up the thing and he injects himself. And I'm like, well, you're just setting up the point where you're not going to pick that up in time, and we're going to see you turn into Hyde. And what happens? Yes. Tom Cruise picks up the thing, moves it away, just as he's about to inject himself. He doesn't inject himself. He turns into Hyde. And I'm like, really? Now, really?
Really? That's not his fault. That's the script.
So, yeah, does being involved in a bad film make you a bad actor or actress?
No. Again, he's got to pay rent. So I'm not going to... He don't have to pay rent. He owns houses. Anyway, but it's...
Who's going to take it?
We haven't got finished the list yet. So there's Javier Bardem, there's Russell Crowe, so two Oscar winners, Josh Duhamel from Transformers, we won't go into him, Mel Gibson, another Oscar winner for directing, obviously, for Daddy's Home 2, and Anthony Hopkins, Oscar winner, but for two movies, one called Collide, which I never saw, and the other one, which was Transformers Last Night. So we've got, four Oscar winners in this category. I see Russell Crowe taking it. It has to be Russell Crowe because, I've seen most of the other movies, and the other kind, Javier Bardem in Mother. Again, it's the movie itself. If you're gonna fault anything, you'll fault, and fault is a strong word, but because Darren Aronofsky was the one who did the movie, and he was punting something different. He was trying to be different, and that's what that movie was. It's a Razzie. It's considered for Razzies because a lot of people thought it didn't get what it needed to get, and it was confusing and so on. But I don't blame Javier Bardem for that. Russell Crowe, on the other hand, yes, he didn't write the script. It's not his movie, but still.
He's probably not going to have been that good.
Yeah. It was terrible.
Let's be honest. So,
just when you said Russell Crowe plays Jekyll and Hyde, I immediately cringed.
You should... No, don't. I would say you should watch it to see what I'm talking about. You shouldn't watch it because it's a terrible movie.
It's payback for Les Miserables and the singing.
Do you think he was bad? He was a bad singer in Les Miserables?
I actually don't think he was that bad, but everyone thinks he was really bad.
Yeah, to be honest, I don't think he cares anymore. I think it's just a case where it's like, what are you going to do? He's Russell Crowe. He's like, he's won an Oscar. He's put it in the corner. It's like, yeah, what are you going to do? Take my Oscar away? No. Final category, worst supporting actress. We've got Kim Basinger from 50 Shades Darker. Didn't know she was in that, but okay, fair enough. Sophia Boutella. Now, this is a bit that I feel bad because she's in The Mummy. And if it is anything that's good about that film, it's her. She's fantastic in that movie, but obviously, anyway, doesn't matter. Susan Sarandon in Bad Mom's Christmas. I didn't see Bad Mom's Christmas.
What's
I saw
so
Bad
funny?
Moms. I saw Bad Moms. I really enjoyed Bad Moms. Let me backtrack. I enjoyed Bad Moms, but not enough to go and see Bad Moms at Christmas. But Susan Sarandon being the only one being nominated, I only need to watch it because there were a whole bunch of other people in there that probably need to be nominated as well. But
you
anyway,
think that all of them should be in this list?
Not necessarily, but I need to watch it to see. And I'll watch it and I'll come back to it.
Can I just say one thing, Marcus?
Sure.
Just really quickly, because I know we have to move on. But backtracking a little bit, because I never said this at the time.
Okay.
I only watched 20 minutes of the Emoji Movie.
Okay.
But I'm with Laura on this one, actually. I didn't think it was that bad. Sorry.
Really?
Yeah.
Actually,
I thought it was actually unexpected, it to be much worse.
I watched the 20 minutes of the Emoji Movie, and the only reason why I watched it is because I wanted to see Patrick Stewart as the Pooh.
That was
the only reason.
Okay.
And then once I'd seen it, that was my surprise over and done.
Here's the thing. With this statement that you've just made, the reason why I won't even challenge it is because you said, I watched 20 minutes
of
the movie.
That's right.
I watched 20 minutes of the movie, and so I didn't like the 20 minutes of the movie I watched. You watched 20 minutes of the movie, and you were like, okay, but still, you didn't finish the movie. The movie's not 20 minutes long, is it, Laura?
No, it's more like 90.
It's more like 90 minutes. So there is a good 70... My math is terrible, but there's a good 70 minutes that you didn't watch,
that's
right?
True.
And
that's
you
true.
Weren't compelled to watch those 70 movies. So, actually, 70 minutes, so...
Actually, we were kind of... Our hand was forced. We were watching it with someone and they didn't want to watch it anymore, so...
They didn't like it.
The person had sense. That person had sense because they stopped you from spending 70 minutes of your life that you would never get back. Mm. So, anyway.
Okay.
There are certain circumstances where you... sometimes need to watch these kind of films, and it's mostly when you're sort of locked in a train or a plane and
so when you're held hostage, really, when you're held hostage, that's the time that you should watch the Emoji Movie.
Because this is
Guantanamo Bay type treatment, right? Basically, if you were to punish me, it's like you could stick me in a room, put Emoji Movie on and force me to watch it. That's basically what I'm anyway. That's me enough with Emoji Movie. This is you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I am Marcus Iacco.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
In the studio with us are two directors of the movie God Tech. We have Susana Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey. Tell us about God Tech.
Right. Shall I start?
I'll go. Whoever wants to go. Tell us about God Tech.
Okay, so God Tech actually is an acronym, stands for Genetics on Digital Technology.
Okay.
Okay. And it's a film based about a time in the future, not too distant future, where instead of having credit cards and debit cards to pay for things, a microchip can be under the skin and you can use that to buy things.
So like chip and pin, but it's embedded in your hand.
So you don't need the pin.
Okay.
contactless. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
contactless in its full pure state.
Okay, and it's based on a book, which is God Tech. I'm just holding it up. You can't read it from there, so that's fine. I'm holding up a book. I've got a book written by yourself, David John Jeffrey,
yes.
Called God Tech, The Mark of the Beast.
Okay, so I wrote the book when I was 16.
Okay.
And then I got it published when I was... 23.
You're like,
well, 23? No, I was 30.
Just don't say the
30.
Year. Just don't say the year, because obviously people will start dating you that way.
I'm not going to say the year.
Okay.
Okay.
So you wrote the book, and then you decided to make that into a movie. Tell us about
that
process.
So what happened was I wrote the book, and it got to number 2 in the Christian science fiction charts on Kindle
in
America.
Okay. Okay.
And it's a bit of a random category.
No, well, I was having a conversation with someone earlier. Religious books and religious stories, religious books, religious films are quite successful in America. There's a huge market in America for religious movies and religious books, as you just pointed out. So it went to number two.
Yes.
Okay, so what happened from there?
Okay, so a couple of years passed, and I got approached by Warner Brothers.
Oh, excellent, okay.
Asking if they would buy the rights to the story to make a film of the book.
Okay.
However, they told me that they were going to take out what I thought were key elements of the story. Okay. They just wanted a film about microchipping, basically.
Ah, fair enough. So they wanted to remove the God element, I wouldn't say the God element. They wanted to remove the religious
side.
Okay.
Oh, so I think all of the story context, it's the story of a family, so all of the family side, they just wanted a film about microchipping.
Okay, fair enough.
And I wasn't happy with this, so I said no.
So you walked away from Warner Brothers?
I walked away from the money.
All right.
But wow, that's brave.
That's a bold move. Not a lot of people would do that.
My dad wasn't happy.
Your dad's right now is like, I'm still not happy. Okay, but you're in here as directors of a movie.
So what happened was I got approached by a big name.
Okay.
And they said that we will distribute your film if you make the film yourself.
Okay.
So that's what we started doing. And it was before I met Susanna. It was myself. And I started on my own trying to make this film to start with.
And that gives us a good segue to introduce Susanna. So, Susanna, you came on the project?
Okay, so basically, David and I have common friends. So the person in question was a man called Lamin Tamba, who's a very close friend of ours. And through him we met. It's actually a kind of cute little story because it was through Facebook and then we got in contact and all that. Anyways, to cut a long story short, I'm an actress as well as a filmmaker. Okay. So I auditioned to be in David's film and I got a small part in the film. Yeah. On the day when I was acting in the film, because I went to college and I went to university, I studied both film production and acting. Mm-hmm. David found this out, and he was having some struggles with the making of the film because he doesn't have that background, and he had a lot of, there was some lack of knowledge there that I could help with.
So you've written a book, but you're not a director, but you chose to direct this movie yourself.
Well, I come from a background of photography and DJing, so I had the sound and the picture idea, but I didn't have the whole how to make a film.
Understood. And then you had someone who walked in who was auditioning for the part, and then you basically just gave a promotion and you said, right, you just come and direct the movie and go from there.
It wasn't that simple, but it went that way.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, fair enough. So you then took on the project and then you started, you co-directed with David.
Yeah, so he wanted me to bring in more of the production values into it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, sure.
So, I started telling him that in order to bump it from an amateur production to a more professional production, you know, he had to bring in a sound crew and get better equipment and all that. And I was just sharing my knowledge with him. Mm-hmm.
One more thing.
All right, okay.
One more thing I want to mention.
Okay.
He also, during this time, she encouraged me to take part in film competitions.
Oh, okay. Oh,
yeah. So we started 48-hour film competitions.
That's very good. It's a very good program. It's hardcore pressure cooker where you get a theme, some actors, you need to write the script in 48 hours. You need to write, edit, make a movie and submit it in 48 hours.
Is that even possible?
Yes, it is. And we've got the footage on YouTube to show it.
I took part a couple of years ago and it's an incredible experience.
Did a 24-hour.
You did 24-hour film. Okay,
We did one in Texas when we started at 2 in the morning and finished at 2 in the morning.
Because we were going via Texas time.
Sure.
Yeah, and it was all submitted digitally. That one was really, really hard.
Okay. That was crazy.
Wow. Okay, so right now the movie hasn't been made, but you're currently making the movie.
We're ready to go. We've got everything in place.
Mm-hmm.
We're virtually right there. We're just getting the last bits of funding and then we're ready to go.
So if anyone wants to know more about this movie, where do they need to go?
Well, we got the movie website, which is www.godtechmovie, which is G-O-D-T-E-C-H,
excellent,
movie.com.
And then you're on Twitter,
GodTech Movie.
You GodTech Movie. At GodTech Movie. You're on Facebook at GodTech Movie. Instagram at GodTech Movie.
Not Instagram, but we have YouTube.
You're not Instagram. Okay, you've got YouTube. Okay, so you've got a YouTube channel, and which is also GodTech Movie. That's it. Like, I was discussing this earlier. That's a very sensible way to go. Keep the same sort of label for every single thing. Unlike us that have different labels for different social media sites. But, you know, we won't criticize that at the moment. But that's fine. Okay, excellent. So you're currently in the funding stage. Yes. But you've got all your details on the website, and I've got the book here. I'm going to read the book as soon as I on my way back home, and I'll give you my feedback as quickly as I can.
Please do. We'll go
from there. I'll read it after you, definitely.
Yeah. If you're going to say something positive, leave it on the Facebook.
On the Facebook. If I'm going to say something positive, you think I'm going to go on the Facebook and criticize your book? No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't do that. That's not me. I'll just basically not say anything on Facebook. You just won't hear from me again if I want to criticize. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I am Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
In the studio with us, we have the directors of GodTech Movie. We have Susanna Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey. Thank you very much for coming into the studio with us. I was going to put some music on because we have a musical interlude, but we'll skip it because I know we're conscious of time, and I want to get all of us talking about the different movies that we have lined up. So let's move to the next segment, which is Top 5 UK Box Office. Okay, so at number 5 we have Early Man. Have any of you seen Early Man yet? Okay, it's an Aardman animation. I love their stuff. This is one I want to go and catch before it drops out of the charts. I haven't had the chance to watch it yet.
It just came out last week, right?
Yeah, but it's a number 5 at the moment, so I don't know if it's going to go higher up in the charts. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But I do want to introduce my kids to this as well, because Aardman, they did Wallace and Gromit, they did Pirates movie, and they're very good. They're excellent storytellers, and I want to introduce them to this as well.
Actually the thing that's being pushed hardest at my local cinema in northeast London, and a couple of days ago there was a nice big queue of parents and little kids saying, well, you know that these filmmakers are the people who made this thing that Daddy used to really like when he was a child. and just the whole kind of asterisk-ness that I think will be in it. I haven't seen it yet, but this weekend is the weekend.
Okay. I really want to see it.
I think because Half Term's coming up, not this coming week, but the following week. So I think there'll probably be a big push then. So we'll see then. Number 4 is The Greatest Showman. This is with Zac Efron, but obviously starring Hugh Jackman, Michelle Williams, and Zendaya. Have any of you seen that yet?
My entire family have actually seen this, but I've been away all month in Japan where it's not out yet. Okay. So I've been dying to watch it all month, and I now have a hot date tomorrow.
Iki Elamriti came in last week and she raved about the movie, especially the soundtrack. So it is one that's on my list, but I've got a number of other ones that I want to go watch first. So unfortunately, although I'm a huge Hugh Jackman fan, that's going to have to wait. Number 3, Maze Runner, The Death Cure. So this one, I've stayed clear of Maze Runner mainly because when the first one came out, it was around the same time Hunger Games was pretty much running through, and I was thinking, I don't really want to get myself invested in it anymore, and so on. But I started hearing some people say great things about the Maze Runner series, also some pretty shoddy things about the series. But that I shouldn't follow what they think. I should go watch the movie myself, and judge for myself. So what I'm thinking of doing is actually doing like a binge weekend where I'm just basically going to get the first two, watch both of them, and then go to the cinema and watch Maze Runner Death Cure. Especially, there was a story that came out about something that happened during the shooting. There's a scene in it in particular, I think it's one of the ones in the trailer, where one of the main actor, I can't remember his name, but he gets hit by a car, as in the car actually hit him in shooting. So they had to shut down production for quite a while. And he went to the hospital and he came back. I think he broke his back or something. It was a very serious injury that he had. So because of that alone, I want to watch the movie. Just say, look, the guy had the dedication to come back and do the work.
Definitely.
So just for that alone, I think it deserves me going to watch it. Number 2, we've all seen it, Coco in 3D.
Brilliant. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Amazing.
I mentioned last week that it reminded me of another movie called Book of Life, which it kind of does.
Yes. Yeah.
There's similar themes about death and music and remembering people, remembering those. And it's, I guess the themes are closely aligned because it is pretty much, they're both focused around the Mexican Day of the Dead. Mm-hmm. So I hate Pixar. I honestly hate Pixar because Pixar makes me feel feels, and I don't like feeling feels every now and again. And they're the one production company that almost every time they come out with a movie and I sit down and I watch it, I just want to cry. Aww. And it's just I hate
in a good
guys.
Way. In a good way.
Make me feel feels. No. I want to feel.
You
I
hate.
Have
you hate Pixar for having power over your emotions.
I want to feel emotions when I'm good and ready. Okay. I don't want to have to sit down and watch a Pixar movie and want to cry about it. So that's just me. I don't know. It's just me.
And yet you do.
And yes, I do. And I will keep going back and I'll keep watching their movies, which is why I'm kidding. I don't hate Pixar. I love Pixar. They basically, with the exception of the Cars franchise, Cars and then Planes, I think they've pretty much hit every film. Every film for them. Oh, and The Good Dinosaur, I think.
Though Coco, although I loved it, and I'd love to watch it again in cinema, I found it a bit cliche-ish.
Okay.
The bit at the end with the where you know...
It won't spoil. Okay.
Where you know that the...
Sure.
...person...
Sure.
...is not who he says he is.
Sure. Sure.
Yeah. You know that's going to happen. You feel it coming.
Do you know, I actually didn't.
I
should have seen it coming, but I actually didn't.
I think writers should be banned from seeing all movies. You know, because if you're a writer and you understand how you understand the nitty gritty of the way that films are written and the way that story reveals happen, then you can just sit back and kind of. Be all like, oh,
I still
that
Titanic.
Coming about it.
What I'm going to say
for us,
David,
normal people, you know,
David, my answer to that is not every movie has to be The Sixth Sense, okay? Not every movie has to have a twist that you don't see coming, right? So even if you know you may have picked up along, I still think that didn't ruin it for me.
It was a great film. I do want to go back and watch
film.
It.
You should.
I'm just angry that we had to wait so long for it. The Latin America. America got it first, I think. North America second. The entire rest of the world, it feels like, apart from Japan, got it third. Then we got it, and it may be, you know, maybe in 6 months' time, the rest of East Asia will get it.
I have to confess that we actually saw the Portuguese version first.
Oh, okay.
we were.
that would be because because you're Portuguese.
Yes,
so,
I'm Portuguese.
Okay, okay. I guess from the name. So it's,
yeah, we watched it with my family.
Okay, so do you speak Portuguese, David?
Not enough.
Oh, but you watched it. You saw subtitles.
I understand enough Portuguese to be able to watch a Pixar cartoon.
Okay. Yeah. Well, don't know. You just keep asking. What is he saying? What is he saying?
There's quite a lot of repetition.
Actually, that's one thing that's good about Pixar. You can watch it with the sound down and still work out what's going on.
That's true. Mm. That's true. And number one, Darkest Hour. This is good. This is the movie that's going to get Gary Oldman that Oscar. I said that last week. The movie itself is okay.
I thought it was quite wonderful.
You thought it was wonderful?
Really.
Okay.
I saw it just yesterday, and I was so impressed, not just with Gary Oldman and Kristen Scott Thomas's performances.
Ah, yes. Okay, okay.
But the economy, I think, of the way it was put together, it really focused on just those weeks.
Yeah.
And the parts that they choose to show, I just really thought that it was well-crafted, well-chosen storytelling.
Sure. I'm not going to criticize the movie at all. My main takeaway from it is just Gary Oldman disappears in that role. And that's the one thing is just he's virtually... There was a point where you have to just say, is that Gary Oldman? But yeah, it's absolutely. And that's the reason why I think he's going to win the Oscar. So with the fact that I think it's nominated for Best Picture as well, I don't think it stands a chance against Dunkirk, Shape of Water and all the others that are there.
No.
But it's a great movie.
There is a 5-minute...
For me, I'd say it's a good movie.
I think the first two acts are better than the final act.
Okay.
Apart from the famous speech that everybody knows. There's in the run-up to that, there are some fairly cheesy moments.
Okay. See, I wonder if I wonder because
I wish they'd dealt with differently.
Because it's number one now. I wonder if it'll then rocket up the charts again after the or around the Oscar. If there's going to be a big push around the Oscars around Oscars in March. So we'll see. We'll come back to it. Anyway, that's the top five. The UK top UK box office top five. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
In the studio with us, as we're live streaming on Facebook, just in case anyone's watching. Hi, we haven't forgotten you there. In the studio with us, Susana Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey, the directors of God Tech the Movie, which was a book written by David John Jeffrey, which I have in my hand. We'll move on to our next segment, which is our top five favorite movie. Sorry, our top five favorites film and TV discussion. So the question that's been bouncing around today is, what is the definition of a cheesy movie? And I think I think we had different opinions, but they kind of all melded into one. So I'll give my definition, and if you disagree,
oh, by the way, our top five discussion is about cheesy movies.
I'll come to that. I think they gathered that from the fact that that's the segment that we're. Anyway, done that. So, our top five is top five favorite cheesy movies. So, what is a cheesy movie? We figured a cheesy movie is a movie that it isn't necessarily strong in the intellectual offering that it has. It's mainly there for cheap enjoyment, cheap thrills. It's easy to watch. It's often disregarded by a lot of people, but it's just fun to watch. Just switch off and watch. Is that what you figured a cheesy movie would be?
Yes, it was. And I also had a quick look online earlier, and the definition that I found on ranker.com was actually pretty good. It says, it's not always bad movies per se, but our sort of cultural zeitgeist... Mm-hmm. I don't like the word, but, you know, has determined that they're just too much in some way. You know, too sugary,
too,
you know, too obvious, mm-hmm. too this, too that. And that's, I think, really the one thing that brings together such an enormous universe of movies that most of which I actually quite love. But, you know, fantasy movies, romances, you know... Movies that have a kind of element of camp about them go over into cheese quite.
So well, I think it's down to perspective.
Of course,
I think it's to do with your age as well. I think if you're a, you're a younger person mm-hmm. and you look at an older person, you go, "Oh, that's so cheesy."
So what you're basically saying is that I'll look at you and say that no, I'm kidding.
Oh, vice versa. And I think that it's purely like down to a culture. And what you've been brought up into.
That's true. Mm. So with that in mind, let's go through our number fives and number fours. We'll start with Susana and then work our way around. So what's your number five and what is your number four?
Okay, so my number five is The Room, directed by Tommy Wiseau.
Oh, is that cheesy though? Is it cheesy? Because that movie is just fantastically awful.
Oh, don't get me wrong. I love it.
Okay, I'm not going to criticize any choices. So
maybe,
yeah, sorry.
Maybe I misunderstand what cheesy means.
No. Okay, go on.
No, I do think it's cheesy because I think what I love about the movie is how earnest it is. And I think he really mm-hmm. went out of his way to make something that was like this tragic love story between these three people. And that was his intention.
Sure.
But it actually ended up being this really inept and amateur production.
You know what?
Production.
The more you say that, the more I actually agree with you. So if looking at the movie itself without everything else that happened around it, had it not got the notoriety that it did, it would have just been the cheesiest movie ever.
Yeah.
So I agree. Yeah. What's your number four?
Okay, so my number four, let's see if I can remember. It's Batman and Robin.
That is George Clooney, Chris O'Donnell. That's right. That's the one with Arnold Schwarzenegger. It's
yes. Love the Arnold Schwarzenegger scenes.
Yeah. So
it's
okay.
It's the ice puns. I love them. I think they're fantastic.
I respect those choices. They're pretty good. Okay. So David, what is your number? What is your number five? What's your number four?
Okay. So my number five is Smokey and the Bandit Part 3.
That's cheesy.
Yeah.
Oh, Part 3.
Oh, part
okay.
3.
Okay. Fair enough. I see. Right, so when? Yeah. Okay. Law of Diminishing Returns. Okay. I can. Yeah. I get behind that. Okay.
There's a reason for this.
Okay.
Is that when I was younger, I went out and bought Smokey and the Bandit Part 3, having watched my numbers 1 and 2 and loved them.
Okay.
And my dad said, don't get it. It hasn't got Burt Reynolds in it. And I said, but Burt Reynolds is written on the cover. So I thought, it's got to have it in it. And it has a flashback on it of Burt Reynolds for about 10 seconds.
Nice. Hey, technically he's in it. So yeah. So what's your number four?
So number four is the Flintstones movie.
So you're talking Flintstones, not Flintstones in Vegas.
No, as in the first Flintstones.
John Goodman.
John Goodman.
Who was that guy
who is in Little Shop of Horrors?
Rick Moranis.
Oh, Rick Moranis. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. All right. Okay. I remember that.
I just had such a brainwave just there. Sorry. You'll get to hear about it in a minute.
Are you crossing
Rick
off
Moranis.
Your list?
No, just Rick Moranis.
Sure.
Rick Moranis.
Yeah.
Rick Moranis.
Okay. Okay. Fair enough. All right, so Smokey and the Bandit 3 and Flintstones movie. Okay, excellent. Laura, what was your brainwave for number 5 and number 4?
Well, like I said, I've had serious trouble with choosing between cheesy romance, mm-hmm. which is super different, but just as amazing,
okay.
as cheesy fantasy. So mm-hmm. if I speak really fast, I might be able to get more than one in per thing. well, the first one, actually, my number 5 is quite easy because... all I really need to say is Patrick Swayze.
Of course, Donnie Darko is considered a cheesy movie.
In the real world, Dirty Dancing.
Sure.
Well, the real-ish sort of a world.
As soon as you said Patrick Swayze, everybody knew you were talking about Dirty Dancing.
And also Ghost.
Oh, yes. Ghost. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. Yeah. Okay. Okay, yes,
it's,
I agree.
It's pretty cheesy how the baddie gets his comeuppance at the end.
So you're basically just saying your number 5 is Patrick Swayze. That's it. It's just Patrick Swayze.
Anything that he's in
yes.
that I've seen, I have slightly hidden at the back of my wardrobe,
sure.
but got out
okay.
every so often when there's no one else in the house.
To be honest, now that you say that, I'm thinking of all Patrick Swayze movies, and all I'm thinking, I am thinking cheese. It's like, what's the Roundhouse movie, the one where he's a bouncer? Roadhouse. That's it, Roadhouse.
Mm.
So that's pretty cheesy. Anyway, so that's your number 5. What's your number 4?
My number 4, I've got a real world and a fantasy one as well, I'm afraid. Pretty Woman.
Yep.
And Armageddon.
Oh, nice. Okay, so you got 2, Pretty Woman, Armageddon.
They're both big, they're both bright, they both have a weepy bit
sure.
at the end. And also, they start really quite brilliant actors who are clearly having quite a lot of fun
in these
really heightened, fairly silly versions of people.
I agree with you. And one of those movies is going to occur again in the list. So we'll get to it. My number 5 is Snakes on a Plane.
Nice.
So Samuel L. Jackson, Keenan Thompson. Keenan Ivory Wayans is someone completely different. Keenan Thompson. I'm stuck. sorry. Just knocked myself on the head. And Lin Shaye. So this is the movie is exactly what the title says. Snakes on a Plane. You get a whole bunch of snakes. You throw them onto a plane. You get Samuel L. Jackson to go in and say, get these Emma effing snakes off this Emma effing. I can't say that because it says on the sign. I shouldn't swear. Anyway. But yeah. So I love that movie. I was like one of 12 people in the cinema watching it when it came out because there was a huge fan buzz about the movie and loads of fans were like, yeah, keep it as it is. Let Samuel Jackson go in there. Let him say that line and so on. And nobody showed up to come watch it because the people who were promoting that movie online went and watched it online. So it didn't make that much money. But Snakes on a Plane is my number 5. My number 4, Armageddon. Michael Bay, Bruce Willis, Billy Bob Thornton, Ben Affleck, Liv Tyler, Mark Clark Duncan. It's like you throw a dart at the
Aerosmith.
Board. Aerosmith. Aerosmith, Liv Tyler was, she was like the only woman in there, but the only woman with lines in there. Keith David, Steve Buscemi. So tons of excellent actors in that movie. It's cheesy as heck. I love the fact that it was in competition with another movie at the same time. You know how Hollywood spits out the same movies and whatever. So it was that and Deep Impact, and Deep Impact just got eclipsed by Armageddon, and still is. People don't really know what Deep Impact is, but it's literally the same story.
I have to do is think of that last scene, and I just the lump starts to come back into my throat.
Sorry?
Doesn't have Steve Tyler singing.
Deep Impact Deep doesn't Impact, have to. Yeah. That's, maybe that's where they went wrong. They should have gotten Steve Tyler. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
And in the studio with us, two directors of the God Tech movie. We have Susana Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey. And we're talking our top five favorite cheesy movies. Susana, I believe it's your turn to say number three and number two.
Okay, so my number three is Street Fighter.
Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Classic.
Yeah, it's two reasons. Jean-Claude Van Damme is one of them.
And Raul Julia.
I love Raul Julia. I think he's amazing. And I love that he's a Shakespeare-trained actor.
Yes.
And he brought some real ham. It was such a hammy performance.
He's Gomez in the Addams Family as
he
well.
Yes, absolutely.
And my favorite line, I just have to say this from that film, is it goes something along these lines. I don't remember it exactly. When somebody comes up to him and he goes, "Oh, there was this day when you came and you ravaged my village," or something. And he was like, "On that day, I ravaged your village, but to me, it was just a Tuesday. Brilliant. It was my favorite line. I love that.
That's a good call. Good call. I'm with that. Street Fighter. Okay.
And my number two might seem a little bit weird, so I'll explain really quickly.
Sure.
I've picked Little Shop of Horrors.
That's not weird. That's a good call.
I won't
go cheesy, but anyway.
The reason why I think it's cheesy is because he has the whole angle of the good guy who's in love with the girl, but she's in love with the bad guy, and then she realizes the bad guy is not good for her, and then she goes with the good guy even though he's not your classically handsome.
Uh-huh.
You know, but of course it's also a fantastic movie because he has the brilliant music. It has Audrey 2, my favorite thing in the whole film.
Absolutely. So. It's again Rick Moranis appearing a second time. Steve Martin, Bill Murray is in it as well. It's like, I've been looking to watch that movie again. It came up in the conversation when we talked puppets, then when we talked puppetry.
Weren't there puppets in Honey, I Shrunk the Kids? That was a Rick Moranis film.
Well, yes, probably.
I don't remember.
I don't remember puppets.
A giant snail or something. I don't know.
Maybe. Okay.
Perhaps I'm making
Brilliant.
It up.
Okay. But
Little Shop of Horrors.
Yeah. I keep mixing that. Little Shop of Horrors is your number two. Excellent. Yeah. David, what's your number three and number two?
Number three is The Expendables.
One, two, or three?
I'm just going to stick with one for now.
The Expendables franchise.
I mean, when you started that, how could they do a two and three?
Hey, they found a way. I have to admit, one is my favorite, absolutely. Two was, they were pushing it too much. Three kind of redeemed it for me because they brought Antonio Banderas in it, and he's one of my favorite actors in that regard. But yeah, anyway, this is your list. So Expendables, go on.
Left Behind with Nicolas Cage.
Left Behind.
With Nicolas Cage.
The one with it's the one about the after
people disappear.
Yes.
Nicolas Cage
lands the plane.
Yes, it's the rapture happens.
The problem
I
have with this is I read the book.
Yep.
I saw the original movie, and I thought the original movie was cheesy.
Yep.
And then I saw the movie with Nicolas Cage.
So, Laura, we had a conversation about this. Laura, you were talking about the original movie, which was out in the early 2000s.
Yes.
And then Nicolas Cage did
a Nicolas Cage version.
The original version was really much more for the Christian community who had made the Left Behind series that's eight books in it, a huge bestseller. The authors Tim LaHaye and Jerry Jenkins they got really rich off that series.
Okay.
And then they made the film, and then Hollywood realized that Christian community made movies make a lot of money.
Yeah.
And then it got greenlit in Hollywood.
All right.
And the Left Behind, the reason why I thought it was cheesy was because it was basically, it wasn't, when I saw it, I didn't see Captain Raymond Steele.
Uh-huh.
I saw Nicolas Cage flying a plane.
Every movie is Nicolas. I saw a headline that popped up where someone's invented this app that allows you to substitute Nicolas Cage in any movie.
That's brilliant.
I want to see that. I want to see a Nicolas Cage version of Raiders of the Lost Ark. I want to see a Nicolas Cage version of Passion of the Christ. I want to watch Nicolas Cage do anything. I want him to be the Shia LaBeouf of our generation. That's basically
He's
it.
Awesome.
So you've given us number three and number two. So number three was Expendables. Yes. Number two was A Left Behind.
Yes.
Laura, what are your number three and number two?
Well, my number three in the real world is...
You keep saying in the real world. It's like,
In the recognisably not that much supernatural stuff going on,
sure.
Although, you know, dogs might be better behaved than they usually are,
okay.
Is Legally Blonde.
Oh, yeah.
It's arguably not cheesy because it's got such a strong message and it's kind of turning lots of cheese tropes inside out for a really good cause.
Okay.
But my sisters and I adore this movie.
No, it's
Reese Witherspoon
film, yeah.
is one. I think it's one of her best comic roles.
Mm-hmm. Luke Wilson's in it as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, and the sequel as well. I really think both of them together, I could watch them as a double bill.
So you say in the real world, is there something coming up? Is there something else in the fantasy, or is that number two?
The other one is an animation called, I don't know whether you saw it, called Fern Gully, The
yes.
Last
yes.
Rainforest.
Yes.
It is really cheesy.
It is cheesy.
it's so obviously against acid rain, which was, you know, in the early 90s was a really big PR thing.
That's interesting. So your second choice was cheese, and it's great choice. The fact that everyone else has been talking cheese, where we're talking either romance or we're talking action.
Mm.
And that's the first one that's cheesy, more about the environment.
Mm.
So it's something that's not romantic. It's not action inside him. It's about...
But except they're killing the trees.
Yeah, so the violence is against it.
No spoilers.
Okay.
Well, yeah, so it's just too much, like the trees crying and the fairies being really upset and, you know, all the baddie being not only a smoke cloud who can sing like Tim Curry, but who, you know, this enormous bulldozer thing that was just like going, oh, we really enjoy making rainforests go away for no reason.
Yeah.
You know, it was even at the age of 8 or 9 when I first saw it, apart from loving Robin Williams's raps as a bat, which I still remember all the words to, I did find it
a little bit
a little bit one-dimensional in its message.
Okay, so is that your number two, or
that's,
is that
that's
tied?
My that's my number three.
So three
all
is,
of that is my number three.
Three is Legally Blonde and Fern Gully.
And my number twos are 13 Going on 30, which I watched again last week. It's amazing.
That's what's her name from Alias?
It's Catherine. No.
It'll come to me. Karen.
It's Catherine Heigl.
No, it's not Catherine Heigl. It's the lady that's from she's Elektra. She's from Alias, the series.
She's in Juno.
I know her, but I forget her name.
Jennifer Garner.
Jennifer Garner. And Princess Bride.
I saw a list that said Princess Bride on Cheese List, and I was like, no, it's not. I know it is.
It's cheesy.
But that's the whole point.
It's cheesy, like a Sinbad movie.
But it's a cheesy movie. It's a cheesy movie that knows it's a cheesy movie. I mean, even the fact that...
Does that make it not cheesy?
But that's the point. We need to have a
philosophical discussion in another for another hour.
That's true. That's why I didn't want to pick it on my list, even though I love Princess Bride. Anyway, my number three and my number two... we can speed this up. It's Cruel Intentions. Sarah Jessica Parker, Reese Witherspoon, you mentioned her, and Ryan Phillip. Felipe.
Brilliant.
Love that movie.
You mean Sarah Michelle Gellar?
Who did I say?
Sarah Jessica Parker.
I meant Sarah Michelle Gellar. Thank you for correcting me.
Sorry.
Otherwise, it would just
go
Sarah Michelle Gellar, and not the other one, Buffy. My number two is Mamma Mia.
It had to come up.
I wish you hadn't mentioned this close.
I
love that movie.
It's a brilliant movie, but it's
very
cheesy,
though. It's cheesy.
It's cheesy in the nicest way.
Yeah, you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I am Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
And with us in the studio, Susanna Rodriguez and David John Jeffrey, directors of God Tech, the movie. We are talking cheesy movies. We have 2 minutes left to go. So what is your number one?
My number one is The Princess Bride.
Princess Bride, okay, fair enough. David?
Superman 4. Quest for Peace.
Yes, Quest for Peace. Good.
And that again was like Ferngully. It was a.
It was about the effect of nuclear arms. Yep, absolutely. Laura, what's your number one?
My number one is 9 to 5. And
yeah, Dolly Parton.
And the fantasy one is Fifth Element.
It's not cheesy.
It's not cheesy.
Okay, fine. I love that movie. It's a great movie.
Yeah, it's just too. If it had half of the camp in it, it would still be the campest film I've ever seen.
I'll let it go. My number one is Showgirls, Paul Verhoeven movie. I love that movie. It's cheesy as hell, but it's a funny movie. Anyway, so we're in the last stretch of the movie of the show. We just want to talk Netflix, Amazon movies. Do you have any recommendations, Netflix or Amazon, or anything on TV?
I heard Stranger Things is good.
Oh, it's amazing! It's an amazing show. You should watch it. Laura, do you have anything to recommend?
What did I watch? No, actually, I've completely forgotten about it. I'm too busy thinking about Fifth Element now.
Don't worry, I'll recommend.
Which you can actually watch on Amazon Prime for free, I think.
I'll recommend Altered Carbon. It started today on Netflix. Go check it out. It's got Joel Kinnaman in it. It's an amazing show so far. I want to thank David and Susanna. Thank you very much for coming into the studio with
us. Thank you for having us.
And next week we have Brian Kurt James Hammond, author of A Case for Murder, The Brittany Murphy Files. He's coming in to join us. Until then, you've been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm Laura Sampson.
Thank you for listening.
And see you next week.